Hey, this is our last lecture, in fact, which is kind of crazy. It's only a little bit left. It's also my last lecture, well, second last lecture for my first semester. So as an official professor. So it's kind of cool. Let's see. So today, just a reminder of when the final exam is and that it's in this room. And I'll talk about the final exam a little bit more later in the lecture today. So starting off, I want to kind of quickly review what we've been talking about so far. And these are some things that you should definitely be trying to pick up on, because it's likely that some of this will be on the final exam. If you want to look at numerical optimization so that you can try to figure out what are you getting the best answer to your question is basically what it's for. The way I was used to hear it described is, nobody ever calls me. Why are they calling me now? So if you do numerical optimization, so basically the way it was described to me originally when I first heard about this, although mostly we've been doing this in kind of like 2D, but if you kind of imagine like 3D, and so you're like, you know, maybe on like some sort of sports field with a round ball, right? Maybe a soccer ball. It's a really bad field, okay? And so there's a bunch of depressions around on the field. And so what you're looking for though is where's the deepest depression, okay? And so if you think about that, right, what you do is you kind of roll the ball around on the field until it falls into the deepest hole. The thing that gets tricky about it when you talk about like kind of as you get into like machine learning and stuff like that is ensuring that you're in the deepest hole, and how do you get out of a small hole to kind of continue rolling around, right? So if, you know, you only have a certain amount of power on your ball that's moving, if it gets stuck in a small hole, it's got to have enough power to get out, right? And so there's various techniques you use to do that. But that's the way I kind of think about it, is this optimization technique is you're trying to find, you know, the biggest hole in a big plane. But in the case that we're talking about here, it's simpler. So it's usually only in like 2D. But even as you start to get into those, some of the examples I've shown, but we're not really kind of covering too heavily, where you get to like quadratic equations, things like that, you start getting more dimensions, right? When we just say X and Y, so like a line, right? That's only in 2D, right? It's got X or two dimensions, right? It's got X, it's got Y. When you start adding other dimensions, it starts getting more complicated. Actually, in another talk I give about something else I work on, I actually show a whole bunch of n-dimensional objects and like trying to show pictures of n-dimensional objects, which is really complicated and weird. But I think you get the idea. So we have this handy function called minimize which will basically take kind of any input function and look for the smallest output of that function given basically every possible input. That's what I want to say about this. So we talk about when we're trying to do this analysis of how the quality of our results is, we start to look at what's called the least squares line. It's mentioned in the prior slide, RMSE, right? So even though it's often referred to as least squares line or regression line or best fit line, it's usually involves, it's a little bit more math than that, right? In a sense, not a whole lot more, but that's kind of what they're talking about, is you're trying to find the best mechanism to do your estimation. All right. So, and then finally, we're pretty much going to close most of this out with is residuals, which is kind of like a remainder when you did, you know, really, really simple division, probably a long, long time ago. And so it's the residuals are the leftovers when you try to do an estimate, and then you try to figure out how far away you are from the real answer. And so those residuals will tell you how good an estimator you are, or how good an estimator you tool you have. So that way you can kind of look at the data you do know and look at the residuals on the data you do know for the estimation. And then you might be able to, you should be able to guess how well your estimator will do when it has things where you don't know the result, right? This make sense? Okay. All right, so back to the dugongs, because everyone loves a manatee or something. All right, and we introduced this a little bit last time, but not much. So the first thing I want to show you is that I need to run these cells so that we have some tools. And so what I want to point out here, and in the kind of class version of this Jupyter Notebook, this is there. But these are some really useful functions that would be really useful for something like the final exam, right? So first we have a calculator that will turn things into standard units, okay? And why do we do standard units? Does anybody know? Why are standard units useful? There's two big reasons. Anybody know? It's not that late in the day. Come on. Why do we use standard units? Yeah. For correlation. But kind of before that, is there a kind of a more abstract reason that you'd want to use a standard unit? Or like you want to standardize your units, essentially. So one is comparison, right? And then kind of in the standard deviation, in the correlation scenario, it kind of makes math work, right? But in the first case, it's so that you can have comparable things, and kind of the one leads to the other, in that if you have those kind of comparable things, that's what makes the math work in a sense. So standard units are very useful. Obviously, they're not that useful to actually get to your estimate, right? Because you got to convert it back into whatever the original unit was, so that you don't end up with, $1 when you actually mean, 10 million or something. Okay, and then we have a calculation for correlation, which in turn uses the standard units, as you just said. So it uses that function here, and then it basically takes the average of the set of standard units. And then here's a slope calculator, okay, which uses the correlation to help figure out what the slope is along with standard deviations. These are the built-in functions. You don't have to know how they work per se, but you should know how to get to standard deviation. So if you had to write a standard deviation calculator, and then let's see, and then basically, it returns the result, which gives us the slope, right? So it takes our correlation, and then our y standard deviation and our x standard deviation. Then we have a calculator for intercept. And so the intercept, we have another basically formula to get to the intercept, which uses averages largely. And then, see if I could just grow, it would be a lot easier. So fitted values. So what are the fitted values? Do you remember? What does fitted mean? Yeah, it's the estimate, okay? So when we say best fit line or whatever, a thing on the best fit line, right, is the fitted value. Part of the reason I keep hitting on that is one of the hardest things I think to learn in any kind of new field or new subject is slang, right? Or the jargon. So I keep trying to hit those to make sure they're clear. And it uses the slope and intercept calculators in order to figure out the estimates for the values coming in so that it can do an estimate on that table. Then we have the residuals calculator. Okay, so the residuals takes those predictions by calling the fitted values, okay, so it gets all the estimates, and then it basically does a subtraction so that it can find out what the difference is between the y's we know, okay? And then when you want to plot, this is just a plot residual, sorry, this is just makes a pretty picture, okay? So don't worry about that one too much. But we will look at it. All right, so here's our dugong data, and as I mentioned last time, I think, what we want to do is try to predict the age of the dugong based on the length of it, right? So as with most things, as an animal gets older, they tend to get bigger, right? However, I would also guess that they probably also stop at a certain point, right? They don't just get endlessly bigger. That's not true, in case you're interested, for living in Boston, right? That's not true with lobster, for example. Lobsters will get just continue to grow. And they are, I think the current theory is they actually will live forever if they can. The problem is they get killed and eaten by people like me. But they do, you know, they will essentially live forever and continue to grow that entire time. I think some of the science is a little like dicey on this, because obviously getting a lobster that has lived forever is hard proof. So, you know, don't necessarily entirely quote me, but I'm pretty sure it's pretty close to correct, or the current thinking of these. So we have a bunch of data about some various dugongs. And so what we want to do is, the first thing we do, right, when we want to try to figure out if we can make predictions about this, is see if we can use a linear model to make it easier. And so what do you all think? Does this look like a linear model? Does that look like something we can do there? It's a little curvy, right? But on the flip side, you know, maybe, you know, or maybe we could try to stick a line in there and see what happens. So the first thing we want to do is figure out what the correlation relationship is, right? So because of the shape, we know it's going to be a positive, and we know it should be less than one, okay? So we know it'll be above zero, but less than one. But we don't know exactly how much. So I can't remember what that number is. So that's about 0.8, okay? So that's a very high correlation, right? So it means we can, we can get a pretty good accuracy theoretically if we're running that line in there. But then this is where the residuals come in handy, which is we start to look at our estimator, right? So that's the yellow in here, is our guesstimates as to what the value should be. Then we subtract the difference from the values that we know, and we plot that on this graph down here. And is that a good looking plot for a linear outcome? All right, I see somebody shaking their head. What do we want to see if we want a linear regression that's working? Right, a cloud center around zero, right? So something blobby, because what we want is like really good distribution of errors that are positive, that are, you know, the errors that are wrong in the x direction and in the y direction, right? But also negative. So we want kind of it to all even out, because that means our line is like right in the middle of our, you know, football shaped cloud, right? This almost looks like maybe like a U, right? Like a curve. You know, it's not pretty for this outcome. What I think is funny is like this is the exact opposite of what we want for a correlation graph, right? Which kind of makes sense, right? Because what we're measuring here is the opposite. All right, so here's just another example. So this is trying to predict weights of American women based on their height. Again, seems relatively plausible. However, there might be limits, but you kind of would expect somebody who's, you know, 6'2" to weigh more than someone who's 5'2". And as you can see, this correlation here is nearly one. If you round it, it will be one, right? I mean, 99.5, right? That's pretty high. So when you get that close to one, as I've also mentioned before, or negative one, right? That's often an indication as well, there might be something wrong, okay? Because when you're if it's really perfect, that's probably a sign that either it's not real, or that you made a mistake, right? But even as I think we talked about, right, even if you make a mistake, it's really hard to make that good a mistake. All right, so we can plot the residuals on that one as well. And you know, kind of lo and behold, oh yeah, this is not good at all, right? However, I mean, it does tell us some stuff, right? So in here, right, maybe it isn't terrible. You know, I mean, I guess it's not really balanced even here. I'm saying this with a zero if line. But as you can kind of see from the fitted value, you can kind of tell from looking at it that it's not great either. But long story short, right, this residual outcome says no bueno, right? This isn't good. So just to kind of put that into a slide, let me make this a little bigger so I can see it a little better. So we want just a blob of points, right? And you will, if it's a nonlinear relation, you'll often see a pattern. Okay, like we kind of saw almost like two U curves there in those two examples. But it's a good test. And basically, sorry. So, you know, what I kind of showed mostly was, you know, kind of trends or patterns, right, in the residuals, but also big outliers or a lot of outliers that aren't balanced, right? So, you know, essentially it kind of comes back to that balance, is that, you know, if the residual scatter isn't balanced, it probably means something's wrong. All right. Then talk some more about those. And so when we look at those residuals, so we're looking at the dugong data here, and we know the residuals indicate that maybe it's not a great linear regression. Sorry, let me just catch up on my cheat sheet here. So what would you expect the average to be if we take all those residuals and average them out? I know what I expect it to be is the opposite of what it is. Anybody have any ideas? Actually select. So it's just zero, okay, or really near zero, right? I mean, we're rounding for math errors. Anyone know why it would be zero? If you round down you take the averages of those, the average of all those residuals. Any guesses? Because you're still going to have a fair number of both positive and negative results, right? And so when you average it out, it just comes down to zero. So for most, or maybe even all, residuals, when you take the average, it's just going to be zero. All right. And then, so if we take, this is the Galton data, which I kind of preloaded, but didn't really talk about, which we know is actually pretty good at this, right? We know there's a pretty good line in there. So we still get the same result. It's still just zero. All right. So maybe not terribly useful at the moment, but you know, there it is. All right. I'm just going to make this table, which actually I think I did already, but I seem to have it twice. Now I lost my place. All right. So does anybody have a theory as to what the correlation between the mid parent, okay, so the, you know, the average height of the two parents, and the residual from the estimate. What do you think the correlation between those two things might be? Any ideas? There's a pattern to my madness. It's still just zero. But for some reason, it takes more calculation time. So this is a weird thing about programming and math. This is actually somewhat language dependent, but in Python, there you can get a negative zero. It's exactly the same thing as a positive zero. It's basically how the engine behind it is working. For whatever reason, underneath, the math was easier based on you were kind of doing it in negatives or whatever, and so you ended up carrying a negative sign. And because Python doesn't know about zero, really, it just says, oh, I got a negative sign, I gotta show it. So anytime you see a negative zero, it's just a, you know, like a printing error. It's still exactly the same number as far as all like calculations and everything else are concerned. Let's see. Oh yeah, so the correlation between basically, so this is our x-axis, right? So our mid-parent heights going across the bottom. And the errors, there's no relationship between them, okay? And then the fitted values, right? So that's our y-axis, but this is the estimates versus the real values. There's also no relationship to the errors, okay? And this is more kind of a data point than it is like, you know, a thing that you can leverage well. All right, so we want to get into this a little bit. And so this is just our favorite Galton Heights table. And so we have our fitted values that are in the yellow. So basically those are our estimates. And we have the actual values where we have them, which is the blue. And, you know, funnily enough, right, the things that we can't test here are also not shown here, right? Because we didn't fill in the line for the gaps. But those are the things we could actually find out if they were really doing estimates, right? But two quick concepts that I want to point out, and we're not really going to talk too much more about this, I think. But we refer to this one as an informed estimate, okay? And this one as an uninformed estimate. Okay? And the difference between them is that, like, with the fitted values, what we did was we took what we knew about the children, right? And we drew a line, and then we started doing estimates. And so then we can take the standard deviation of that, and we'll get a standard deviation with an informed estimate, okay? But another way we could do this that would obviously be less good is we could actually just take all the children, just take all the heights of the children that we know, you know, assuming we don't have the mid-parent height information. And we could take the standard deviation of that value, okay? Which is gonna tell us, remember what we're getting with standard deviation, right? It's kind of like a window, right? Like how big is the window where we can make predictions? And as you can see with the informed version, we have like a window of size like 1.1 and a window of size 3.5 when we do the uninformed. So again, kind of like a data point is, you know, this is what we call this kind of thing, and this is what we call this kind of thing, all right? There's usually not, that I've seen, too much of like gradation between it. You wouldn't normally say like more informed or less informed or something like that. It's kind of a binary uninformed or informed like prediction model. All right. And then to kind of round out some of the example, we can take those two techniques, right? And we can actually try to figure out what's the difference between them.
Well, like I said, I don't think we're gonna get into too much detail on this because I wanna cover a couple other things.
So we'll just kind of talk about a couple more examples where we can do it with the dugong data as well, right? And we can figure out what our fitted values, right? So our informed one and our uninformed one, column one here is just the whatever it is, each. So, you know, the second column over, right? Because we always count by zero.
And then again, we can kind of figure out what's the difference.
I skipped the correlation one up there, but so this is kind of telling us the correlation. But if you notice, there's a relationship between the correlation and taking the informed and uninformed estimates or whatever and dividing, right? So they look like they're equal, which is kind of another interesting piece of information, right? Is that maybe another way we can get to that correlation is by taking the standard deviations, right, of the estimations and the standard deviations of it as, or the standard deviation of the uninformed version, divide them by each other. And then we get, interestingly enough, the same number, right, the same result, the same R, as if we did a correlation calculation using the mid-parent and child information. And then the same is true with the dugongs, right? We can find out that the correlation is whatever that is, 83 maybe. But then if we go kind of the other way and we take the informed and uninformed and do the division, then we find that the correlation is, or the result is the same value as the correlation calculated the way we know how to do a correlation. Which obviously opens up more opportunities. And then kind of as our last example here, this is back to the hybrid car stuff. And so we know that as acceleration goes up, the miles per gallon seems to go down, right? Which, you know, kind of makes sense because, you know, when you do higher acceleration, wait, did I say that the right way? Yeah, so
higher acceleration.
Miles per gallon goes down. Yeah. Okay. And which, if you think about it, makes sense, right? Because the engine is going to use more gas, right? Or even electricity, right? It's going to use more energy to make it go faster, even though I don't think there's any pure electric cars in here. But then we can pull the residual map off of that, off those differences after we do an estimate. And you can see this one actually looks pretty good. Right, that's a little bit more like what we want. We have a couple of outliers, right? But they kind of match, right? So it's not, it's probably not too bad. And so then we get a correlation if we calculate it out. And in a sense, even though it's not anywhere near as good as the, you know, the 0.9 or whatever we got, this seems a lot more reasonable, even if it's negative. This seems like a lot more reasonable for a correlation between those two things. But then we can do the same trick here and try to get to the correlation in a slightly different way. Except you notice that we lost our negative sign here. Okay, so it's not quite as good, or it's not quite right. So what we end up with is a formula that looks like this, right? So if we take the standard deviation of the fitted values and divide it by the standard deviation of our known values, or y, we'll get the absolute value of r. Okay, so it doesn't tell us whether it's a negative or positive correlation. It just tells us the number, and then we have to figure out whether it's negative or positive. And then, like, this part is what leads into other stuff that we're probably not going to, or we are not going to talk about today. But yeah, so that's the idea. Do you have any questions there? I'm going to switch topics pretty hard for a second. Okay. Oh, sorry. So I wanted to, I have a couple of slides about it. I think, so the property of the residuals, right? So if the residuals are from a linear regression, they always have a zero average of the RMSE, right? Or the SDE of the residuals, the standard deviation of the residuals. There's a zero correlation with X, and there's a zero correlation with the fitted values.
So these are some good ways to make sure you're doing things right.
And as I, you know, like, okay. So what this leads us to is maybe a few questions. All right. So this part, y'all have to like, you know, try to answer the question. Because otherwise I can't figure out a way to do right and left hands on this one particularly well. So the first question is so imagine we have a regression line. So we have our estimation line, we know where it is, and we calculate the residuals, but we notice that the average of the residuals is actually a 10. Okay. So, and the 10 is a little arbitrary. It doesn't really matter what the number is, but we have a number that's positive and it's greater than zero. What can we do to make our regression line better? So let's break it down a little bit, right? So if the average residuals is a 10, that's a positive number, right? So what does that mean when we talk about that blobby scatter plot? Yeah. Right, so it's kind of shifted above zero, right? So what does that mean for our estimator calculations? Right, right. So that whole like block, it's still a block, right? But the whole thing's kind of shifted up. So it's not real balanced on the negative side. So that means that our regression line is what? And just think about it if you think of a positive regression, or sorry, a positive like correlation. So it means that our line is too low, right? What we want to do is move the line up so that we get more negative errors. That makes sense. So if you look at the picture, or I'll try to show. I don't know if I have a good example of the actual case, but so if we look at this line, right? If we shift this line upwards, then that means that our estimate calculations, right, are going to get. There's going to be more of the fails on the downside, on the negative side. So that way, if our regression blob is too high, or you know has a positive, right, it means that our line is too low. In the case of a positive correlation. All right. So then, if the residuals were positively correlated with X, what do you think that would mean? So this means that, so our X values, right, are at the bottom. And it's saying that there's a relationship that as the X's get more positive, so do the errors. Okay, so as the X grows, our errors also grow. So that could be, but if it still looks right, it may not be. So let's assume for the sake of argument that it is a linear regression, or a linear regression would work, let's put it that way. What else could we do to make it so, because it's very consistent, right? It's not like we have a curve or something weird like that. We know that as the X values go up, we know that our error values also go up. So what could we do differently to make it so the error values stay closer to the same? And I'll try to do it with pictures by showing it here, right? So basically, imagine that this, as it goes over here, the white around the line increases, right? So basically, this thing starts to turn into like a Y shape. Oh, sorry, but not on, but only for the errors. Sorry, this isn't really showing the errors, but imagine. These blue dots were errors and not Y real values. So if it turned into kind of a Y shape for the errors,
What does that mean that we should do? We need to adjust the slope, right? Because what's happening, right, is that that split, it's saying that we're getting further away from our estimates whenever we get a higher x value. So if we adjust the slope, it should make it better.
Okay, and so,
were actually answering this question, not that one. So in this case, if the residuals were above zero in the middle and below zero on the left and right, so kind of like an arc, right? That's probably nonlinear. Like you're kind of out of luck. There's nothing really you can do to kind of make that arc kind of flatten out when it comes to errors or bubble out, I guess. So that one's, that's probably just the, you know, what you're into. So why do we have these examples, okay, or these questions? Is because this is how the residuals are helpful when you can't do like a really easy, clean estimator, or you're not sure how good your estimator is. So what you can do is you start to look at the errors and it starts to inform what you can do to your linear regression to try to make, basically what you want to do is make the errors better, right? But better is both like more accurate, but also more consistently accurate, right? So even if they're, you know, if they're still negative and positive off your real data, what you want to do is you want to be as close to in between them as possible so that when you get to something where it's an unknown, you're as close as you can be from the estimate to the real thing. So, and I think, I mean, you know, we basically just said this, that like this one is the X goes up. I'm just trying to explain my shorthand here, but as the X goes up, the residuals also go up. So increase the slope of your regression line. That one, you know, if the average residual is, 10, right? So it goes, it's up, then raise the line by 10.
All right. And then I thought I was supposed to go back to the slide first. All right. But I don't think we have more notebook. So as I promised, we are going to do the other survey real quick. So this is the one that's for us. It is now anonymized. And hopefully has some fun questions. But I would like to give you, you know, let's call it 10 minutes maybe to try to answer them. The very last one, I think I'm very curious to see the results of, because I have a very strong opinion on this subject. Currently, I'm winning. I think it's because I'm the biggest. All right. So hopefully, during the course of the semester, you have heard us talk about kind of the ethical choices around some of the data stuff that we have looked at or what other people have done and things like that. And in retrospect, I should probably have introduced this, like, kind of a definition at the beginning, right? Instead of just kind of alluding to it. So this is just a definition of ethics, right? So the moral principles that govern a person's behavior or the conducting of an activity. Mostly we care about the conducting of an activity here. And why is this such a big deal? And I heavily borrowed some of these slides from a very nice woman on Twitter who gave me permission to use them literally an hour before this. So
But I figured, you know, borrowing, stealing someone's content that was literally on ethics was like really a break in ethics right there. So I generally am very careful not to borrow other people's content without talking to them first. Sorry, I just want to make sure the recording started again. Yeah. So, but in this case, I was like, maybe I'll be extra sure. So in what we can do, right, with data science, with computers, with whatever, I would actually draw this green circle way bigger. Like the stuff we can do, the stuff we can find out, the stuff we can, you know, whatever, is mind-bogglingly large, okay? Then when you talk about an organization, particularly for-profit, you know, capitalist organizations, they have a stake, like this black circle. To some extent, I would say this might even be bigger too. They actually have an ethical responsibility to their owners, okay? That might be shareholders, that might be the people who literally own the company, whatever. They have an ethical responsibility to maximize the amount of money they can make, okay? In violation of most other scenarios, right? Like their primary responsibility, sometimes, and in the US, for example, covered by law, okay? Like a CEO is personally legally responsible for maximizing the profits of the company, right? So you take those two things, right? And you take something like tech, which let's just say we have perfect legal regulation in the world. Tech changes so fast that it just, you can't keep up, right? And I wouldn't even argue that we have good legal regulation in general, but let's just say even for this, even if we did, it wouldn't matter. I heard a great quote actually once. I don't know, has everyone here flown on a plane? Okay, you have to turn your phone off, right? Or at least at takeoff, right? Do you know why that is? I may know. The navigation or whatever. Yeah. So that is the commonly held belief that, you know, that whatever, you know, the signal on your phone would interfere with something to do with navigation. In fact, it is not true. Okay. Or at least the vast majority of cases. However, the FAA, who regulates that in the US, recognized the fact that computers, phones, right, change so fast that they didn't want to risk it. Because who knows what will get introduced in a phone next week that can mess with navigation or something to do with the plane, right? So they actually went kind of the other direction and said, you know what, we can't keep up with this. There's no way we can. So we're just going to make a regulation that says, you cannot do this in these scenarios. And, you know, if you've been flying as long as I have, you would have noticed it's actually been getting laxer over the years, right? You were supposed to keep your phone off basically the entire flight, right? And then it's been slowly getting relaxed. But the point being is that technology and regulation have a very hard time regulation keeping up with technology is very hard. So what that means is there's a bunch of humans in the middle here, right? And we as humans need to kind of try to take into account the ethics of a scenario such that we can balance those three things, right? I mean, obviously there isn't much to balance with doing it legally. You should do things legally, but balance at least what the organization would like to do, the tech, what you could possibly do, and ethics, right? So that's why we care. So, and we're gonna ask this question because this will kind of reinforce some of my point. All right, so I've been playing around with this blue bike data, right? So we have these columns of information. So we have the start and end times of a trip. We have the locations of where they start and end. We have the age of the user or the bike rider. And we have the gender of that bike rider. All right, so let your unethicalness or ethicalness run away with you. Give me some ideas what we could do with that data if we had an interest in, you know, making money or, you know, causing something to happen based on this data.
Okay.
Right. So you can do like targeted ads, right? With the start and finish, right? So maybe at the end. So there's actually a really good one of these by way of example. On I often take the commuter rail inside Boston because it's shorter. But there's an ad on the train that is a Worcester train. So it actually runs from Worcester into downtown. And the ad has said, tired of your commute? Come work at Worcester University, Worcester College, something. And which is brilliant, right? Like, you know, because nobody likes taking a long train ride if they can avoid it. What are some other ideas? Yeah.
If you see that maybe like if a certain gender is using the blue bikes at a disproportionate rate, like for example, like men, make the blue bikes bigger to accommodate the fact that men are taller on average.
Yeah, yeah. Right. So, you know, basically inform the kind of the quality of the product based on some of this information that you have, particularly like gender. So one of the things I would point out is that maybe the problem is the reason that men are using them more is because they already are too big for most women. Right. So that's like, that's kind of on the edge. Both of those are a little bit on the edge of, are they ethical or not? Where they kind of bring up an ethical question in the sense that making those choices encourages a particular behavior. Are you sure that's the behavior you want to encourage? And is it ethical to encourage that behavior? So I think, unlike many people, actually think advertising can be very ethical. It can be very positive because I may not know that I really could use this pair of shoes, right? There's, if I'm a certain type of user or whatever, that maybe there is a reason why me buying that pair of shoes would be better for me. And that there's an argument to be made that marketing can be a good thing because you are actually informing, you know, potential customers of something that may benefit their lives. Not always, and you have to cut, you have to be careful of that line, right? So that's, I wanted to give a couple of those. We don't have a ton of time. I wanted to try to end a little early today, but I wanted to point out another one, which I think is really interesting. So there is a public data set that I haven't used in this class, but you can go and get it from boston.gov, which tells you historical places where gunshots have been fired in the city. So what could you do with that information?
There.
Right.
In order to increase value and like lower crime areas.
Right. So one of the ways that, and this is one of the ways that that data is actually used, is basically to inform kind of real estate in general. Like, I don't know about necessarily specific instances, but that is definitely one of the ways that that's used. Any other ideas? Go ahead. Right, so that's a particular one I was looking for. So you could use this information to inform where cops should be in advance, right? Or more regularly. Do you see any ethical problem with that? What is it?
The fact that places that tend to have more violence on average are over-policed.
Well, a lot of this data is causing them to be over-policed. It's hard to say whether they were necessarily over-policed before. I actually think shots fired is less bad for this, but this is where one of the big ethical problems occurred, has been occurring over the last few years, is they're using crime data to put more police in those areas, okay? Which seems like a good thing, except what happens is if you put the police in those areas, the crime goes up because more people get caught for crimes that normally might not be a crime, right? Or may not be that big a deal. So, which then encourages more crime, which encourages more cops. So that's where kind of you start getting into the ethics part of it, where whether it's a good idea or not to actually do that. So I wanted to give a couple of those examples about, you know, what to think about when you're looking at some of these questions. And what I really want to point out, okay, is that one of the best ways to get to making sure you're doing things ethically is by having a group of people talking about it, preferably a group from different backgrounds, okay? Just like we did in here, you know, and it's a little abbreviated, you know, we could do a much longer discussion. But if we can get a group of people who come from different backgrounds, who are looking at it from different perspectives, then we're more likely to not make stupid ethical mistakes, okay? Or ones that we're not gonna see until later, which are in some ways even worse. So what I wanted to quickly flip through, and this was the big thing I wanted to ask that professor for, is here is just a sampling of some of the massive ethical problems that have been going on over the last few years. So this was a website where people who wanted to commit adultery could go and find other people who wanted to commit adultery. And then they released all the information. So that was this. So that was entertaining. Then this is another one about a dating website. And basically that this dating website was collecting significantly more data than they indicated to their users and then modeling based on it. And then this one, now people are starting to use AI for trying to figure out what the sentencing should look like. And this can be a problem because like there's a reason we have human judges, right? And actually sentencing guidelines are often considered an equity challenge right now, right? In that, you know, like there was an example this week, I think this guy, a billionaire, he got in trouble for having appropriated millions of dollars, like $10 million worth of basically artifacts from various countries around the world. And, you know, so essentially stole them. He was asked to give them back. There are also cases where, you know, some, you know, teenage, young adult from not necessarily the best area steals a pack of gum and spends a life in jail, right? It's completely wildly different. And some of that, some of the argument there is it's about sentencing guidelines. So another example, you know, mistakes are super big deal as well. And so that's why I like to point that one out too. And then this one, here's another challenge, right? That isn't necessarily obvious from a kind of an ethics perspective or whatever is, so Strava is a running app, tracks your runs, tells you, you know, how far you went, where you went, et cetera. But it also tells the public, assuming you release it. But it has, because you imagine, right, soldiers do a lot of running, also revealed a bunch of places. There was a thing years ago with Google Maps was a big problem for this too, because the satellite imagery of Google Maps was showing pictures of a lot of places that they were not supposed to show pictures of at all, right? You know, military installations being a good example. So interesting. And then this is where it also gets interesting from if you want to end up in a career in data science or software engineering or anything related, is when you go and work for a company like Google, what is your responsibility to what they are doing, right? So I was just talking about this with somebody else in the office. The, you know, medical professionals in many ways are protected by the Hippocratic Oath. So before you can become a medical doctor, you have to take this oath, okay? What that oath says, one of the things that oath says is that for anyone, if they are having, you know, a medical event, you will treat them, period, end of story. Not for money, not for anything, right? You will treat them. So in the US at least, this is kind of a problem, right? Because it's pay healthcare. So what's interesting is that an ER, an emergency room, will always take a person, whether they can pay or not. As you might imagine, hospital administrators are not the biggest fan of this scenario. However, the doctors can, without like going out on strike, and without any collective bargaining or anything else, they can say, I literally, you know, made an oath that says I cannot require someone to pay. So there's been talk, and the reason I was talking about this with somebody is that in the software development world, there's been talk of a Hippocratic Oath for engineers. Is there something like it that, you know, anyone who's ever worked in software development should also have to sign, you know, or agree to? So let's see, which one's this? Oh, this is Cambridge Analytica, which not our Cambridge, other Cambridge, I think, right?
Mm-hmm, it is.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. There's a company in Boston that does basically monitoring of social media for your company that is called Crimson Hexagon, which I'm like, could you pick a more evil sounding name? I mean, like, really? Like, it's like it's something from a movie. So this was just Cambridge Analytica, almost with the collaboration of Facebook, was able to violate the privacy of, you know, huge amounts of people and have a huge impact on the things that they did. And so this falls to, right, this is a corporate responsibility, but this is also the individual developer's responsibility. You need to be participating. You need to understand what it is you're actually participating in and making right and making choices about it. You won't always make the right choice, don't get me wrong, but at least you're making a choice. Amazon has been working with the police. It's really funny. I don't know if you've seen Amazon's stores that you don't have to pay in. You know, they've talked about them. We don't have one here. They're supposedly talking about putting one in here. But that's actually where they've been testing a lot of this facial recognition tech. And then they're also using it with the police. And then there was a big stir a couple of years ago now, maybe, about basically a bunch of Facebook software developers saying, you will not work with them anymore, or we're going to walk. There's been some limited effect. So, you know, does anyone see here why this is a problem? Yeah. So no privacy, but it's also, the other thing I would point out, well, two things. One, you can make all sorts of predictions about what you're buying, but just because you're in the shot doesn't necessarily mean you're being identified correctly. That's a huge part. For one of the things they've discovered is that most of this tech works quite well on white men. And that's it. You know why? Because you know who wrote it? Mostly white men. And so they tested it on themselves. Yeah.
We've also, the city of Detroit has had a few issues because they used it in arrests and they arrested the wrong African American man.
Right. Oh, yeah. Yeah. So that's right. So again, I reiterate, you know, the more people we can have participating in the conversation, the better. All right. I want to close. I was going to talk about some more of the exam. Well, not really more, but just, does anybody have any specific questions? I posted all the lecture notebooks, so they should be there. I haven't done like this week. So I haven't done the video for Tuesday or today. And I'll post the notebooks for those as well. I should be able to get them up today with any luck, but worst case it'll be tomorrow. Any other questions? Anything that, you know, when you were starting to look at this that you wondered about? So despite the short shrift, we kind of gave ethics in a formal way. If you couldn't tell, it's pretty important to me. So, you know, come and talk to me about it if you're interested. I think it's really interesting. It's got a lot of problems because the trade-off, right, is that some of the most fun things to do in software or data science or whatever are also the most unethical. So it's like, I really want to work on this, but it'd be really, really terrible. So I really, really can't. So that can be a hard kind of hurdle, right, that you have to think about as well. All right, let's call it there.